The rapid growth of the Brotherhood of Locomotive Engineers paralleled massive expansion in railroad construction. In the 1840s, railroads had gained acceptance in America. Trains traveled between Chicago and New York in just 2 days. With deeds to government land grants in their back pockets, the railroads pushed west toward the Pacific. And in 1869, the Central Pacific and Union Pacific Railroads were joined by the Golden Spike at Promontory Point, Utah, forming the first transcontinental railroad.
Hundreds of new companies were chartered, and competition for new track was intense. Speculation led to unethical business practices and neglect for the engineers' safety and security. Stock manipulation and overextension of certain railroads took them into unprofitable territories. At the same time, the U.S. economy collapsed and millions of workers lost their jobs.
Strikes and labor unrest were rampant throughout this period. Two railroad strikes in particular would have tragic yet historic consequences. In 1877, a strike began in Martinsburg, West Virginia, then spread like wildfire to engulf the entire Northeast. Federal troops were called in to suppress the strikers with orders to shoot the strike to pieces, and that they did. By the time President Hayes declared martial law to force the engineers back to work, more than 100 workers had been killed. But the Brotherhood continued the struggle. A decade later, engineers and firemen began a 10-month strike when the Chicago, Burlington, and Quincy violated seniority agreements and began dismissing workers without just cause. The railroad hired gangs of thugs and Pinkerton detectives with repeating rifles to intimidate, injure, and even murder the strikers. BLE Division 62 was broken financially. All its striking members were fired and blacklisted from the industry for life. And still, the Brotherhood continued the struggle. This was the management style of a handful of tycoons who rose to fame and fortune on the backs of the railroad workers. Robber barons disregarded public safety in the name of profits. They paid starvation wages and crushed competition to create monopolies that could keep prices high and wages low. And still, the Brotherhood continued the struggle.
We had some rough times back then, but there was a lot to be optimistic about, too. When our delegates convened in Chicago in 1887, the Union had grown to 372 divisions. At that convention, we found a new partner, the Grand International Auxiliary, which was formed by the wives of engineers who helped with the convention's arrangements. The GIA's assistance and charitable work have been invaluable over the years. Renamed the BLET Auxiliary in 2004, they continue to play an important role in advancing our struggles.
Finally, after half a century of unethical business practices, unregulated growth and bloodshed, the federal government passed legislation to rein in the industry, due in no small measure to the BLE's efforts. The 1893 Safety Appliance Act kicked off nearly a century of strict government regulation of the railroads. Air brake systems and automatic couplers were now required on all trains. These safety devices had been developed decades earlier, but were never installed because they cut into profits. But the engineer's job remained a hazardous one, as a tragic accident in 1900 underscored. An engineer named John Luther Jones, piloting the Cannonball Express, stayed at the throttle and sacrificed his life to save his passengers as the Cannonball plowed into a stalled freight in Mississippi. Overnight, Casey Jones became the nation's symbol of the bravery and dedication of locomotive engineers.
During the late 1800s, through the first two decades of the 20th century, the railroads were unchallenged by any other form of transportation. At the turn of the century, nearly 200,000 miles of track crisscrossed the nation. It was a golden age for the railroads, but not for the railroad workers. Working conditions and pay were nowhere near what these workers deserved. Without skilled locomotive engineers, the railroads never could have responded to the demands of a country growing by leaps and bounds. But little was done to acknowledge the engineers' contributions.
As the railroad industry expanded, the Brotherhood was growing too. In 1900, it boasted nearly 34,000 members in 459 divisions. And in 1908, after having been based in Cleveland for nearly 40 years, the BLE chose the nation's sixth largest city as its permanent headquarters. Construction began on the 13-story Engineers Building, which opened in 1911, and the BLE erected the Standard Building across the street just over a decade later. The union also established its own BLE Cooperative Bank in Cleveland, anchoring a chain of cooperative banks around the country. 50 years after its creation, the Brotherhood had become a formidable American institution. And now, more powerful than ever, continued the struggle. In 1915, the BLE, along with other unions, pressed for an 8-hour workday in the railroad industry. When management rebuffed their demands, the workers found a powerful ally in President Wilson, who called on Congress to pass the landmark Adams Act of 1916. The leader of the Brotherhood, Grand Chief Engineer Warren Stone, said that 1916 will go down in history as the most eventful year of the organization. "We are making history so fast that it is almost impossible to keep up with or grasp it. Every day brings new developments, yet we believe in the end it will all work out to the advantage of every man who toils." Stone was right. With the world at war in 1917, a rail system capable of transporting large amounts of wartime goods and military personnel was needed. Short of resources, with a fragmented and outdated infrastructure, and many railroads in receivership, the industry was not up to the job. The government stepped in and nationalized the railroads. The infrastructure was streamlined and improved, and standardized wages and work rules were afforded to the engineers and workers in other crafts.
After the war, a heated debate erupted over the future of the industry. Rail labor, with the BLE in the lead, favored the Plum Plan, which would have bought out the private owners and maintained public operation under the supervision of a board composed equally of representatives of management, labor, and the public. Ultimately, though, the industry was returned to private ownership. But post-war America was a different country.
Airplanes and automobiles challenged trains for both cargo and passengers. Henry Ford's Model T was affordable for millions of Americans. And more Americans were taking to the roads, not the rails.
In the 20s, we fought hard to preserve what the Union won during nationalization. Congress passed the Railway Labor Act in 1926, and a new form of labor relations was born that still exists today. The law constrained the railroad workers' right to strike, but in exchange they received federally funded arbitration of minor disputes that had led to strikes in the past. Under this new system, the BLE reached an agreement with 54 Eastern railroads that added almost $7 million to the wages of 30,000 members.
When the Great Depression struck in 1929, railroad after railroad sank into receivership. The BLE spearheaded the fight for pension and unemployment security, leading to the creation of the railroad retirement system. And the union, along with the rest of rail labor, won severance pay and other economic protection for workers who were harmed by rail mergers with the historic 1936 Washington Job Protection Agreement. Once more, the Brotherhood continued the struggle. Meanwhile, to compete with other passenger transportation, the railroads developed a new, improved passenger train during the 1930s. The Streamliner boasted luxury, style, comfort, and conveniences unlike anything ever seen on the railroads. While it boosted ridership for a brief period of time, in the long run, the Streamliner couldn't compete with the convenience of automobiles and the speed of airplanes. When global conflict broke out for a second time, the locomotive engineers carried their load and more in the fight for freedom. BLE members ran the trains that carried 90% of all military freight and 97% of all military personnel during World War II. Once again, Railroads and the men who ran their trains played a major role in the Allied forces' success. But the jubilation of victory was followed by a period of long, steady decline for the railroad industry.